Good. Hey, good afternoon, everybody. I'm Charles Shapiro, President of the World Affairs Council of Atlanta. Today's program on Nigeria and human rights is brought to you by, in fact, you, the members of the World Affairs Council. If you watch this program and you're not a member, please join. That's how we support our programming. Our moderator today is Amanda Mattingly. Amanda, with whom I had the honor to work at State Department, gosh, a while back, is the chair of the council's member forum steering committee. And that's the group that puts on these member programs, and I appreciate it. Amanda was, until recently, a senior director of the Arkin Group, a company that does political risk analysis. And Amanda, at this point, I'm gonna turn this over to you and mute my camera and my microphone, and the program is yours.
Okay, great. Thank you so much, Charles. And thank you, everyone. Welcome to the June Members Forum. I'm very pleased to moderate today the really important discussion. And we are very honored also to have with us today my dear friend, Kehinde Togun, who is here to give us an update on Nigeria. Kehinde is a senior director for policy and government relations at Humanity United. He has led global democracy and governance programs in the Middle East and Sub-Saharan Africa for, more than 15 years now, Kehinde, right? We're so fortunate to have Kehinde here with us today, and he's gonna give us an update on the current situation in Nigeria, including information on recent attacks on human rights, civil liberties, and free speech. So welcome, Kehinde. We're so happy to have you. Welcome to Atlanta, virtually.
Thank you, Amanda. And thank you to the council for having me, to the World Affairs Council for having me. It's great to be in Atlanta. This is probably as close as I will get in the pandemic period. So thank you.
Right. Well, thank you. Well, let's just jump right in, Kehinde. I wanted to start by asking you first about the Nigerian government's ban on Twitter. And it seems like this is the most recent assault on free speech in Nigeria. And it comes in the wake of recent citizen protests against excessive force by the police against the Nigerian people, particularly violence perpetrated by the special anti-robbery squad, or SARS, the end SARS protest that we saw in October last year. And so I wonder if you could give us a lay of the land and explain to us how these two things are related.
Yes, absolutely. Thanks for that question. So I think as I was thinking about this and talking to a couple of friends and colleagues about Nigeria in preparation for this, I think a couple of things that we all sort of like agreed on or that kept coming back is like there's what I'm coming to call sort of insecurity, ineptitude, and then impunity, right? And I think if you think of the, and they all build on each other, I think is part of the broader point, right? So the insecurity in Nigeria is really just rife across the country. And so it used to be that we talked about the north of the country as the place where violence was most rampant, right? So we think of Boko Haram, we think of the kidnappings of children, of girls and boys, of children. And then we think of that violence that's happened. And that's what we think of when we think of Nigeria. But then that's sort of over the last couple of years is really expanded, where we now have insecurity across the entire region. So if you think of the northwest of the country, right, where the Fulani herders and the farmers and herder conflict is now becoming a bigger problem, right? Like, so folks who are cattle herders wanting to graze their cattle and saying, we need this land, so we will go through. And the folks who are farmers living there are saying, well, you can't graze on our farmland because that's a problem. And so you see the violence that has erupted as a result of that. And recently, we're seeing that spread into the southwest of the country, where it was last week where there was violence the Fulani herdsmen going through the southwest of the country, right? And then if we think of the southeast of the country, where the, historically speaking, you think of Biafra and the Biafran War, which was the secessionist, the civil war in the country for secession, right? And you have the indigenous people of Biafra, IPOB, right? And then their armed wing that has continued to essentially call for secession using various means. And so you see this insecurity just pervading the country. And then the response has been this, what I would consider ineptitude of the government's inability to respond, right? And so the government doesn't really have enough programs, or perhaps the to be fair, it's a hard, Nigeria is a hard place to manage, right? So like, I want to be conscious of that. But even in that context, what we see is an inadequate response and an inept response to that problem. And the government's response has been a militarized and over-securitized solution, right? So you've got the military deputized, you've got the civilian security forces deputized to protect the country, or to quote unquote protect the country. And so they've essentially, they're using security weapons to protect, right? And what the Nigerian people are seeing is like, this is not a solution. So there's still a problem. And then that's resulted in the informal security sector and what we consider non-state actors also running rife in their own attempts to be their own police. Because when the government isn't providing what the government should, people become their own governments, right? So like, you have people who, there's not enough power generated in the country, so people have generators to like have their power governed, right? You have insecurity, so people get their own security guards. You have those private security guards, and then you have the vigilante groups and like the informal security sector sort of like overlaid on top of that. So there's weapons running across the whole country, and then there is violence across the country. And I think when we talk about the human rights abuses, what we're really talking about here is just this, and I'm not making light of human rights abuses, but what we're really talking about is the killing and the oppression of people by multiple groups of people. So it's not just the government that is like just killing or harming its people. You've got these non-state actors also running right and harming the populations, right? And then when you have things like aerial spraying of populations in the name of trying to control the security situation, you sort of see this happening. And then the impunity piece is that all of these actors are acting and there's no consequences for their actions, right? So if the government aerial sprays a neighborhood in the name of trying to get insurgents and terrorists, but the result is citizens that are killed and there's no accountability for that, you have impunity. If it's the non-state actor that's killing people or terrorizing populations in the name of trying to protect its population, you've got impunity. So you've got these various things that are happening simultaneously. And so it's in this place where you see things like the NSARS movement with folks saying non-state actor, oh, actually these are state actors, non-uniform personnel who are harassing our populations and in some cases killing us, this is not okay. So you see the SARS protest that began last year. Or you see folks going onto social media and using Twitter to organize to say these are problems, right? So like, I think the government's ineptitude is extended to not just how do we deal with the security situation, but the inability to control what people want it to do, right? And control the messaging. And so we see the clampdown on free speech, whether it's the passing the laws, it's passing laws or just outright saying Twitter's banned. You see those things as the responses to a government that doesn't quite know how to respond. So I think that they're overlaid on each other, and the Twitter ban is the most recent thing we're talking about, but it's not alone. It's not in the vacuum. It's part of a larger scheme of an insecure country that the government doesn't know how to respond. And then there's no accountability. So the impunity, insecurity, and ineptitude, as I started with.
Okay, so the three I's we need to remember, okay, right? Insecurity, ineptitude, impunity. So what about the civil society organizations in Nigeria? What are human rights organizations, journalist associations and so forth? What are these organizations able to do to hold the government accountable or to provide security or to uphold, you know, democratic freedoms? They are. What's happening on the ground there?
So I was talking to a friend yesterday who said, described this government as the most open that she's interacted with, right? So if you think of the Nigerian government, historically, the military government wasn't very receptive to citizens' voices, right? The previous administration wasn't particularly either, but this government actually listens, right? And I think her point though is like, they listen, but to what end is unclear, because everything that people are saying is not being listened to, right? And so I would say that Nigeria has a very vibrant civil society community, particularly at the national level. If you think of folks like the CDD West Africa, or if you think of Partners West Africa Nigeria or SERAP, SISLAC, there's no shortage of organizations that are historically speaking have been very strong organizations that are seeking to hold the government accountable. and those folks have and continue to do their work. I think what we now see in Nigeria is sort of this new age of, it's no longer civil society necessarily, or only, it's also citizens themselves. And we see young people mobilizing to say, we also need to be part of the solution, or we have issues and we want to get them addressed. And I think what we saw in the NSAR's protest was young people putting their own lives on the line to say, this is a problem, we want solutions, right? So the vibrancy and the activism has certainly expanded beyond the traditional like NGO professional to the average citizen. So I think that we certainly see a lot of that, and that's a great thing to see. What is unclear is what all of that manifests into, right? Because ideally, in the way that governance works is citizens say, here's what we want from you, government responds, not necessarily doing everything that the citizens want, but at the very least grappling with and trying to figure out how to solve that. What I don't think we see is the Nigerian government sort of grappling with and saying, here are the potential solutions to what you're asking for. So I think that that's the disconnect, but there's certainly no shortage of folks trying their best and with clear visions of what to do about the country, what to do in the country. And I was listening to, I think it was Amaka Anku at the Erasure Group yesterday, who was talking at an interview that she had about it's the role of the government to set the vision for the country, and the private sector as well has a role to play in that. And I think what we see in Nigeria really is that vision setting isn't happening. We have civil society groups who are taking the lead on that front, but it's not alone, it's not theirs alone, it's not their burden to carry, but they're all the recipients of the lack of governance that happens in the country.
Right. I think it's interesting that you mention the youth population in Nigeria. For those, many of you probably know, but 70% of Nigerian population is under the age of 35, which is interesting also when you think of the fact that President Buhari is 78. So there's a real age gap there, which I think is probably also playing out right now. But I also wanted to ask you about some of the other potential demographics that are at play. Nigeria is obviously a multi-ethnic, multi-religion nation. And there's obviously the divide in demographics and youth and those that are governing. The three largest groups comprise 60% of the population. So I wonder if you could talk about how these issues play against that dynamic of demographics. And, you know, does one group feel victim to the other? Or is there finger pointing? Is there a north-south divide? Could you help us understand the demographics at play and how that is part of this human rights situation?
Absolutely. So I think it's unfortunate to say, but like nobody in Nigeria, no group in Nigeria has a monopoly on being victimized, because everybody's a victim in the country, right? When there's a government that is insecure, that's not addressing insecurity, everybody has a right, everybody's rightfully upset, and everybody has a right to say, we're not protected, right? So I think I don't want to make light of the Fulani, the herdsman and the farmer conflict, because that is a real conflict, right? Or the Biafran folks saying we want our own independence, right? I think that those are real issues. I would argue that those are all the result of folks feeling like the Nigerian government is incapable of addressing their needs, right? And I think when that happens, that manifests in different ways. It manifests in people feeling like, well, we Northerners have never had our chance, or we Southerners have never had our chance. And I think when there's scarcity, people tend to fight each other over the very little that does exist, right? So I think to me, that's where these divides really land. Unfortunately, I think what we often see is those divides manifest themselves in conflict or in divisions that are across ethnic lines. But I think that those are actually consequences of, or they're symptoms of a larger problem of insecurity and a larger problem of inadequate governance in the country, is what I would argue. I should also say, my father, who's no longer with us, he and I used to argue all the time about the sort of him saying the Yoruba people are an oppressed population, right? And I think that that's from a Yoruba perspective, that he has every right to say that. I'm not sure, though, that from an objective perspective, that I would say the Yoruba people have been more marginalized than any other population in the country, whether that's Northerners who are the victims of Boko Haram in their own region, or the Southeast that has all the wealth of the country in terms of oil, but have never fully benefited from the wealth that comes with. So I don't want to make light of people's perceptions of, including my own families, but I do think that if you look on a macro scale, there's nuance there that we don't often talk about.
Thank you for that. I appreciate it. And thanks for sharing your personal story with your father too. That's interesting. I wonder what this means for political stability for Nigeria in the short term. 2023 is the next election. And then also just in the long-term stability for Nigeria as a one nation. Can you speak to that?
Yeah, so when I talk to friends and former colleagues, I think one of the points that they often stress is the point of social cohesion, right? And I think for a country to have a narrative and a national identity, you need that social cohesion. I think what we see in Nigeria, unfortunately, is that think of the question you asked previously about the ethnic tensions, that social cohesion does not exist. And so how do you create a narrative and how do you form a narrative for a country to progress without that as the underpinning? So I think the long-term prognosis for Nigeria, I'm a natural optimist, so I think it's going to work itself out, or it has to work itself out, but I don't know that I can't look today and say I can see the line, direct line from here to where the progress and the prosperity happens, right? To the more immediate question of the politics, I think if we take factor in what I said earlier about the insecurity in the country and the fact that elections are in 2023, right? So when I was at the National Democratic Institute, 2 years before elections are ideally when you start the electoral process, right? Because you don't start it the week before. At this point, Nigeria this week started doing the voter registration process, right? Like, so what that looks like is folks who were registered 2 years ago have to revalidate their registration. That's now moved online partially because of the insecurity, but at the end of the day, folks still have to go to the to some location to have their identity verified, right? And it's hard to imagine folks doing that in a place where you don't know, like government offices are being attacked in various instances, right? So who would willingly go into the INEC office, the Electoral Commission's office, knowing that that potentially is a target for insurgents or for violence, right? So like, I think that it's hard to envision how Nigeria, at least today, has good enough elections in 2023. And that might very well benefit the incumbent who is like, well, if the status quo exists, then my party, I doubt that, actually he can't run because of the constitution, but like his party, his flag bearer might be in a better position in 2023 as a result. I do think the opposition, there's the opposition says things and issues statements as one does, but I don't know that the opposition is coalesced enough to say that this is where we want to go. And if we look at APC, the President Buhari's party, it took a couple of election cycles for them to coalesce and say the opposition groups to say we will form one party. I think PDP is the opposition party today, but in the desire to be in power and being out of power often creates divisions. And then you overlay the ethnic tensions in the country and sort of which ethnic group gets to be the presidential candidate, which who gets to be the VP and who gets to have their turn. All those things I think are overlaid together to create a complicated scenario for 2023. The optimist in me believes we will figure it out and like we will hobble our way to get there. I just don't quite know the path to get there right now.
Right. Sounds complicated. But thank you for sharing that with us. I've got so many more questions, Kehinde, as you know. But I'm going to open it up to the audience. We have many guests here today, lots of members, lots of non-members. If you're not a member, join the World Affairs Council. If you have a question, please raise your hand in the chat function and I'll be able to call on you. You can unmute yourselves and ask Kehinde your question directly. Okay. So let's see if I'm doing this correctly. Okay, I see that we have our first question from Ambassador Shapiro.
Yeah, thanks. I'm just fascinated by this. I mean, the Nigerian diaspora, particularly in the United States, has done so well in socioeconomic terms. But that Does that carry over at home? I mean, it seems like Nigerians are more successful outside of Nigeria than they are inside of Nigeria. Is that a misperception?
I'm not an economist, right? I don't know that I can answer that in terms of how well the folks within Nigeria are doing. So if you think of Nigeria as like one of the most educated countries in the world, right? Like a lot of Nigerians have PhDs, a lot of Nigerians are very well educated so that when they leave the country, they're very well positioned to succeed outside of the country. So I think that that's one thing to mention. I think the opportunities in Nigeria, the unemployment rates are pretty high in Nigeria, particularly for young people, right? So I think that perhaps is the beginning of the answer to that question of opportunities in the country are not as ripe as they could be. And there's a large population and there's not enough. Oil is still the primary source of income for the country, right? So until we have a diverse enough economic base, I don't think Nigeria will do as well economically as it needs to. And job creation. What's one of the most interesting things about this Twitter ban is a lot of Nigerians actually use Twitter for business, right? So if you think of the fact that the president in banning social media has actually taken away an avenue for folks to actually make their living, it's egregious at best, right? It's just like it's egregious at best and like it's criminal at worst, right? Like there's just things about this, the Twitter ban itself that lets us get a glimpse of what the president or what the government, the Buhari administration prioritizes when economic fuel that social media is secondary to the your threat in the state's corporate, whatever the phrase was that was used in the Twitter ban, right? So like, I do think that there's a people in Nigeria are not doing as well, not because they're not trying internally, those folks have their PhDs or have their master's degrees or have whatever it is that they have in country, the opportunities are just not there. So that when they're able to actually get out of the country, they're able to capitalize on it. Or that their medical doctors and the brain drain that we see on the African continent is Nigeria is very much home to that, of those folks then leave, go to Canada, go to the UK, go to the US, and they prosper because they've been educated in Nigeria, but Nigeria can't reap the benefits of that education that it provides.
I think I saw that unemployment is at about 33%, is that right? I mean, this is coming out of the pandemic now, so I don't know what this, do you know, Kehinde, what the sort of baseline is?
Off the top of my head, I don't know. 33% sounds like one of the last numbers I saw.
Right. Okay. I also, as we wait for other questions from the audience, don't be shy, everybody. We have Kehinde here only for a short while, so make sure you ask questions. I wanted to ask you a little bit more about Boko Haram, and if you could give us a sense of the threat level of this terrorist organization in parts of the country.
So I think, and I would actually be curious, there are the Nigerians on the Zoom, so I'd be curious what perceptions are or folks who study Nigeria as well. I think Boko Haram is still a problem and it's still a terrorist network, right? I think in the last couple of years, the threat level has evolved, right? So like Boko Haram is still able to carry out attacks, but it's no longer what it was in the heyday when like we think of Boko Haram and like kidnapping and violence like writ large. Excuse me, having said that, there's lots of other folks who've like taken over, and are taking, like are very much pervading violence on the country, right? But I think Boko Haram in particular is a problem, but it's no longer what it was, about a decade ago, the way that Boko Haram was like the quintessential problem in Nigeria. I would also say that that conflict has become, or the terrorism group problem in Nigeria is, or it's actually not regional, like there are other parts of the country, of the region of West Africa, where that terrorism and the hotbed of terrorism has like sort of evolved into or shifted towards. But folks in the North would arguably still say, and rightfully say, that Boko Haram is a problem in their region, but it's no longer the sort of the biggest threat in the country or the only threat in the country.
Right. What about, speaking of, you mentioned the kidnapping of girls by Boko Haram. I wonder, just speaking more generally about in Nigeria, Nigerian women and girls have been targets of violence and human rights abuses. But I wonder if, do you see them do you see that as a separate women's rights issue in Nigeria, or do Nigerians see it as a separate women's rights issue, or is it more of the overarching human rights issues or, you know, challenges within the country?
Yeah, so I mean, I don't know that I would separate as a women's rights issue or like a child rights issue. I think that that is that insecurity is a problem that when you have insecurity, marginalized populations are often the biggest victims, right? So I think it's part of the larger umbrella of issues in the country, of security issues in the country. And I think what we saw a couple of months ago, about 6 to 9 months ago, where you saw large amounts of women coming out to protest, right? Some of whom were actually organized again on social media, right? And we saw them saying the security situations affect the situation affecting women in this country is untenable. And so I think that that's part of, but that is part of a larger an insecurity umbrella of which the marginalized populations, women and young people, become the biggest victims. And I think if we think of the COVID, you mentioned COVID earlier, like the consequences of COVID is also, again, the further marginalization of women and girls, right? Or the folks who are, or LGBT populations, or pick any number of folks who are sort of already maligned, who have less opportunity now, and who might be further victimized because they couldn't go out as well as they could have before. I think you're muted, Amanda.
Yes, I was muted. I see. Okay, we have a question from, I'm not sure I can read or pronounce it, Mr. Amosu?
It's me, Akwe Amosu. Sorry, let me just put my video back on.
Akwe, how are you?
Good to see you. Fine, thank you so much. So I thank you so much, Kehinde. It's really interesting listening to you. And I just wondered what you thought about this recent debate about whether the state is failing. I'm sure you read the kind of back and forth, and I'm not asking because of the name calling. I'm just curious about the capability of the state to respond to the present, as you've correctly described it, chaos in security terms. I don't think I can remember a time when there has been such instability in so many parts of the country at once. And I think looking at the way that the police has sort of taken a huge hit in terms of morale at the very minimum, and also just the kind of setbacks on the military front, it just makes you wonder the extent to which the state's got the ability to respond. So I just was curious to hear your reflections. Thank you.
Great to see you, Akwe, and thanks for that question. So I would not call Nigeria a failed state. I think that that's, and again, I think you're right that we want to get away from the name calling. Having said that, I think the reason we want to get away from name calling is so we can actually address the real issues. If you think of what I was talking about earlier, of the Nigeria can't provide enough power for its population, so therefore they get generators. Nigeria cannot provide enough like secure police officers who are armed to get to protect their population, so people get their own security guards. Like the informal security sector is rife because the Nigerian military and the Nigerian force, which is everywhere in the country, cannot protect enough, right? So having said like that it's not a failed state, there is an inadequate and inability to actually respond to the country's problems. So I do think that that's the fundamental problem in Nigeria. And I think not only can it not respond to the security situation, there's a lack of governance. So it can't actually govern its people correctly, and citizens don't have the access to say, like I said before, well, here's what we need from you and the government to then respond to that. So I think in that context, we're beginning to see the lack of responsiveness of a government and the lack of ability to carry out the primary functions of what a government needs to do. I wouldn't go as far, and I actually don't know why I wouldn't go as far as a failed state, but like those become the beginnings of what a failed state looks like, right? So like I think that there is that there. I do think that there are practical consequences of calling something a country like the largest economy, as Charles said earlier, of the African continent a failed state, right? Like I think if that's where we end up, we have a bigger problem. But even without ending up there, I think that we have some major concerns about Nigerian government's ability to respond to its people's concerns and its people's very real problems. So yeah, I think you're right there.
Thank you. Our next question is from Tom Wells. Tom? If you want to unmute.
Okay, yes, I'm trying to unmute. Okay.
Okay, there you go.
I am wondering what the future of the global oil industry is going to have, or how it's going to impact Nigeria in terms of poverty, demographics. Is it going to increase unrest?
Caveat, I'm not an oil expert, so I hesitate to sort of do any forecasting of oil revenue. Having said that, I think that what we saw in the early 2000s, early aughts, right, was the oil was booming. And in that place, Nigeria's oil was worth a lot of money. And unfortunately, that money was squandered, right? And what we now see is that oil prices have bottomed out, right? They've risen slightly in the last couple of years, but they're nowhere near what they used to be. But we also see that the world is moving away from oil as the only source of revenue, or at least the kind of oil that Nigeria has, right? So like, I think if we think of all those things, I would expect in the next 10 to 15 years that Nigeria, if oil is still Nigeria's only primary revenue, we will have a big problem in the country, right? Because like that oil will continue to not be worth as much as it was before, but also the rest of the world is looking away. So until we can define ways to diversify ways of getting revenue and increase GDP, we will continue to not have enough to feed the country and enough for folks to have create and generate their own wealth. I think technology in Nigeria actually is a booming sector. And I think that there's a lot of young folks in the technology sector that I think gives me some hope. But again, those things are until they become fully formed and until they become areas of massive revenue, it's not a substitute. And unfortunately, the Nigerian government, again, to Akwe's earlier question, isn't doing enough to figure out how do we diversify our economy and how do we create jobs. One of the reasons President Buhari was elected in 2015, when he was elected, was because he promised to, APC, the party, promised to create jobs. Those jobs have not materialized. And the diversification of the economy has not materialized. To his credit, for whatever that is worth, in 2019, he was elected again with folks knowing that those things have not happened, right? And we can think of the party structure and like the variety of things that happened to make people elect their leaders. But nonetheless, like the penalty that one would expect for non-performance didn't happen in 2019. And I think that's worth noting as well.
Thank you. Next question is sort of related to the Boko Haram. This question is from Michelle Ball. She wants to know if the ISWAP, I'm not familiar with that group, but if that group is more of a threat than Boko Haram today. Kehinde?
I know Islam, but I'm not sure. I don't know that I would get
what is that group? I'm sorry that I don't know.
Yeah. I forget what the acronym stands for. It's another one of the groups in the country that is, for lack of a better word, terrorizing the population, right?
It's more of a sort of armed vigilante type group, or is it more of a terrorist organization? Or
it's an insurgent group in the country, if I'm understanding correctly. But I think it's a threat in the country, but I'm not sure that I would say. Getting into like the gradations, like which one is worse, I'm not sure. There's certainly, I think that group has more recently been marked for more attacks, right? So perhaps it's the more recent of the attackers, but I don't know that I would get into the gradations of. Michelle, I apologize. I've not studied ISWAP well enough to know to categorically say this is how I would contextualize them.
Okay, thank you. That's new to me. I'm eager to look that up. We've got another question in the chat that is about the international community, and that's also a question I have. The question is, how can the international community engage in business, diplomacy, trade, despite the country's policy challenges? And I'm eager to understand too, what can the global community do, not just engagement with Nigeria, politically, diplomatically, or trade, but also in support of human rights? Kehinde?
Yeah, that's a great question. So Antoine, thank you for asking it. I would separate two things. I think the government response versus the private sector response, I think, are different, right? I think from the US government's perspective, one of the things I would be interested in engaging folks, engaging our government as the US taxpayers on is the amount of weapons that the US government gives to Nigeria, right? Without the question of how are you using these weapons and what does your governance structure look like, right? Like, I think we as the US tend to give a lot of security assistance and we don't necessarily condition those that assistance on performance or on better governance. And I think until we start to do that, we will continue to see these weapons proliferate and be used against populations, not just in Nigeria. You can think of like other countries where the US has supported, not just the US, France, like any colonial power, right? The US would say it's not a colonial power, but pick any Western power and sort of the way that they perpetuated their assistance bits based on security. On the private sector side, I think that there is actually, like I said before, there's a growing vibrant economy in Nigeria and a growing vibrant population of people in Nigeria and like various businesses that I think are worth engaging. There's also, if you think of like corruption and other aspects, there certainly are ways that one needs to be careful, but I think that this is like due diligence and risk management, but in the same context that we have corruption within the US and like the US becomes Western countries become the holders of corrupt actors' wealth. I don't think it's like sort of a one for one of like Nigeria's corrupt, therefore don't do business, right? But I do think that there are parts of Nigeria that are ripe for investment. And I think it's just a matter of doing the work that it takes to get to the place of like, what is that place and who are the right places to invest? And the place that Amanda used to work and that I used to work helps people do that. So I can have ways to mitigate those risks. On the human rights front, I think part of it is the continuing to call out, right? So I think if we think of what's been fascinating about the Twitter ban is like Nigerians are still very much on Twitter, right? They just use VPNs to get there, right? So I think it's the ways that we amplify their voices and the ways that we support their work, right? So like, it's not just up to Amnesty International or the big Western NGOs, it's how do we actually take the folks who are on the ground and the civil society actors on the ground, and how do we amplify their voices and make sure that they're the ones that are prioritized, so that when we're having these conversations, they're the ones that we're bringing to the table, right? And then how do we call out and like ask our government or our governments, whichever respective countries that we're all in, to hold the government accountable, right? So I think that there are ways that we as citizens have a role to play in our own government's engagement with Nigeria. And so I think the government side, the private sector side, and then the citizen side, I think are all parts of a stool, like legs of a stool that would help eventually whatever better looks like become a reality.
Thank you. I like that that imagery of the stool, that you've got these different pieces, different actors who have a stake and have a responsibility to engage. I think that's really interesting. We have I'm sorry, I'm trying to look at the chat and also the hands. Do we have? Okay. I also wanted to ask you, Kehinde, about you triggered another question that I have when you said that Nigerians are actually still on Twitter. What are some of the other social media platforms that, like, what's the workaround that these, that the youth of Nigeria are looking to? I'd read something about an Indian app or social media platform that they were using as a workaround. And I wonder what might come of this. And also, do you think that ultimately, the ban would be lifted on Twitter and other platforms?
I mean, I suppose that as a safe facing measure, the government has to eventually lift the ban. I think that there's gonna be Twitter's done some things to rectify itself and therefore it's okay. I have a hard time believing that come 2023, when the elections are about to happen, that Twitter is still banned in the country. I think that if there's one way for President Buhari's party to not win the election is to still have a Twitter ban in 2023. Actually, I feel pretty firm ground on that one. So I do think it'll change, right? Having said that, I don't think that that's the thing that's going to happen tomorrow, because in theory, they have to actually make the argument that Twitter makes the country less safe. And until there's some whatever that looks like superficial fixes, it'd be hard. It's untenable to say, okay, now we're done. Twitter's good again. On the question of what other platforms, I don't know the India one, so I don't want to speak to that. I know that a lot of folks still use WhatsApp to communicate with each other and to mobilize and say, let's meet in this place, right? And then a lot of folks continue to use VPNs to get around the Twitter ban. So you've seen lots of high-profile Nigerians on Twitter, and the very the announcement about Twitter's ban was made on Twitter, right? So like, I think that there's the Twitter usage hasn't changed and is not going to change. Perhaps folks will be more circumspect with like revealing their locations and things like that. But actually, I think through the NSARS protests, like we sort of saw people becoming better and smarter about how they reveal their locations anyway to begin with. Facebook continues to be a major source of a major use in Nigeria, and not necessarily, I don't know that Facebook is necessarily used for social organizing, but it's certainly still used as a source of information gathering and collection.
Did Facebook take down the Buhari tweet or, you know, post from Buhari like Twitter did, do you know?
I don't know that. I don't think he posted on Facebook. I think it was only on Twitter.
Okay, it was just Twitter.
I think, I'm not positive, but I think it was only on Twitter.
Okay, I thought that was interesting, the decision. It's interesting to think about the, not just with Nigeria, but in other countries, the role and responsibility that carrying out the social media platforms for policing expression and freedom of speech and what role these companies have, I think is really a fascinating issue, not just in Nigeria, but elsewhere too. I know that, India and Twitter have been having issues as well. So that's a fascinating dynamic. What about just more traditional media? What's the role there? And what kind of crackdown on expression within the traditional media, whether that's television, radio, or print?
There's definitely a lot of that. And Akwe, who used to work at BBC, probably can give us a full lecture on that one. Think what we've seen in the last year or so is also just things like the way that the freedom of expression works and the legal landscape changing as well. So penalties that used to be $1,000 in the Naira equivalent have been multiplied, right? So we sort of see the desire to clamp down on what Nigerians can say. And you've got folks like, you've got editors who've been arrested for saying things or who've been visited by the Nigerian version of their the secret service, right? Because that they were saying things. So I think that you see those things that could potentially chill the sector. Having said that, folks like Premium Times, like there's no shortage of, I would argue, quality newspapers in Nigeria that are looking to report, and that hasn't changed. But the landscape that they're operating in is less firm today and more problematic today than it was 5 years ago, without a doubt.
Right. Well, Akwe, did you want, she has another question. Akwe, maybe you could add to that as well. What is your view?
No, I don't. I'm not sufficiently up to speed, I think, to kind of comment on the state of media. I do think that there's a lot of energy to judge from what I'm reading and the way and the interchange between people in social media about what they're reading and what's being broadcast and what's being shared. It feels like a pretty energetic space, and media actors seem to be playing in lots of spaces a pretty good role. And historically, we know that media has also ended up being part of the problem in terms of the politics. And so, you know, I don't feel like I'm up to speed on that question, but I definitely think there's some really courageous, good journalism happening on the ground, and that's awesome to see. No, my question was going to be, not wanting to just, you know, entrap you into sort of impressionistic judgments, but I just, the Twitter ban really triggered for me a kind of question about the diaspora, because the scorn that was poured on the government for this move and the enormous number of, as you say, you know, well-educated, often senior, well, influential Nigerian voices outside of the country meant that it wasn't just a few expats kind of bellyaching. I think it had a huge impact on perceptions of Nigeria among non-Nigerians in the kind of social media space. And so I was just curious what weight you give to the diaspora in terms of shaping domestic politics, if at all. And I don't have a view myself. I'm just curious how to estimate that. Thanks.
Yeah, that's an interesting question, right? Because if you think of the US and the Biden administration and sort of saying like Twitter is not real life, right? Like, I think that's probably the case in Nigeria as well. Like Twitter is not real life. Having said that, a vast majority of Nigerian youth are on Twitter. So that tells us a lot. I think one of the reasons that I think we saw that expat reaction is that I think for a lot of us who are not in Nigeria, we have a vision of our country that we think is problematic of late, but like the idea that Nigeria is now joining this cohort of more restrictive actors, I think jarred a lot of people, right? So the idea that we're gonna ban a major social media company from operating, I think for a lot of folks did not sit very well. And I think that's part of why that reaction was the way that it was. Having said that, I don't think the diaspora actually has a lot of clout in the country. And I don't think that, particularly in politics, right? Maybe on the economic side, they might. But I think when the Nigerian government is thinking, how do we operate in the country and what are the calculations that we're making, they're not looking to folks in the diaspora, no matter how elite or loud that they are in making decisions in the country. But on Twitter, we have quite a loud voice and we very much use it. And I think that's a fair place to be, but it's not when decisions are made, I don't think that's where the government is looking to prioritize or center.
Okay, well, I think we're gonna have to wrap it up there. Kehinde, thank you so much. I really appreciate you joining us. And I know that speaking from all of us from Atlanta, we're so happy to have you and hope you'll come back and keep us updated on everything Nigeria. I'm gonna turn it over to Ambassador Shapiro now.
Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you all for coming.
Thanks, Amanda, and for great questions. Thanks to the audience for terrific questions. And thanks, Kehinde. So you're like watching a tennis player, you know, out trying to get the ball back across the net. I mean, because you've got just such an enormous range of questions. Akwe, I loved your question about the impact of the diaspora through social media back home again, where obviously you can't vote, but you can shape the image of the country internationally, separate from the way the media does. I mean, so that's a fascinating, that's something I had not thought about and that we need to, I have to give some thought to that. That's very cool. So now let me tell you what we've got. We got a great program next week, July 8th at noon, India Rising with Ken Jester, who was the US ambassador to the Republic of India 2017 to January of this year, 2021, and saw amazing development in the relationship of the United States and India during that period. And so that's going to be great next Thursday, July 8th at noon. Everybody, the registration's open. Please register now. I want to thank Valerin Lopez DeFrank, our producer, Laura Brower, our social media specialist, Hannah Rennie, our program director, and our intern, Josephine Steenbergen, who's interning remotely from Italy. That's gotta be tough. And again, thank you, Kehinde. This has been great. And Amanda, thank you for helping us find Kehinde and bring him in to the World Affairs Council. And all of you who are new to us, please join the World Affairs Council. We need you, we need your support. And there is a digital membership if you feel like you'd rather do that than get the full in-person membership. And I want to wish everybody a happy Canada Day tomorrow and a lovely 4th of July weekend. And I will see you all next Thursday when we talk about India. So everybody join us then. Have a great weekend.
Thank you all. Bye.